Video lecture on sampling and quantization by Jeneetha Jabaneza, Associate Professor, Department of ECE, Panimalar Engineering College, Chennai. Contents covered in this video lecture are sampling of low pass signals, quantization, pulse code modulation, time division multiplexing. Sampling process. When a message signal happens to be analog in nature, as in a speech signal or video signal, it has to be converted into digital form before it can be transmitted by digital means. Sampling process is the first process performed in analog to digital conversion, followed by quantizing and encoding. In sampling process, a continuous time signal is converted into a discrete time signal by measuring the signal at periodic instant of time. For sampling process to be of practical utility, we should choose proper sampling rate so that the discrete time signal resulting from the process uniquely defines the original continuous time signal. Sampling theorem for low pass signals. A band limited signal of finite energy which has no frequency components higher than W Hz is completely described by specifying the values of the signal at instants of time separated by 1 divided by 2 W seconds. A band limited signal of finite energy which has no frequency components higher than W Hz may be completely recovered from a knowledge of its samples taken at the rate of 2 W samples per second. So just consider a continuous signal G of t, and this is sampled with the help of time instance separated by Ts seconds. And for this, I have just used a del of t function which is equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity del of t minus n ts. So, the sampled output is obtained as g del of t, which is the instantaneously sampled version of the analog signal. So, this is how the sampling process will be taking place. So, the sampling is done at the rate equal to 2W, which is called as the Nyquist rate, and the interval Ts equal to 1 divided by 2W is called as the Nyquist interval. Let G of t be an arbitrary signal of finite energy sampled at uniform rate Ts seconds, denoted by G of nts, where n is an integer and ts is the sampling period. 1 by ts equal to fs is the sampling rate. It is called as instantaneous sampling or ideal sampling because the samples are obtained only at that particular instant of time. So, impulse train considered for this is represented by del of t, which is equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity del of t minus n ts, where summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity del of t minus n ts is the delta function positioned at time t equal to n ts. So, signal obtained after sampling is g del of t, which is equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of t del of t minus n ts. So, simplifying this, we can write g del of t equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n ts del of t minus n ts, where g of nts is the instantaneous amplitude of g of t. taking Fourier transform of g del of t equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of t del of t minus nts, we get g del of f as equal to Fourier transform of g of t summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity del of t minus nts. We know the rule, product in time domain will be equal to convolution in frequency domain. Hence we have g del of f as equal to Fourier transform of g of t convolved with Fourier transform of summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity del of t minus nts. So we know very well Fourier transform of the signal g of t is equal to g of f, and the Fourier transform of del of t minus nts is equal to fs summation m equal to minus infinity to infinity del of f minus n fs. So g del of f will be equal to fs summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of f convolved with del of f minus n fs. Applying shifting property of impulse response, we get g del of f as equal to fs summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of f minus n fs. So we can expand the summation as fs g of f when n is equal to 0 plus fs g of f plus or minus fs when n is equal to 1 and so on. The spectrum of the continuous signal g of t is given as g of f, which will be lying between minus w to plus w. We know the sampled signal is represented as g del of f, which is equal to fs into g of f plus fs g of f plus or minus fs and so on. So we can draw the spectrum of this sampled signal as, see, the first term is g of f, which will be similar to the spectrum of unsampled signal. So we have the first spectrum, but the magnitude is multiplied with fs. So I have fs into g of 0. The second term what we have is g of f plus or minus fs. First we'll consider f plus fs. So f plus fs will be this. Again, this will be having a bandwidth from fs minus w to fs plus w. So this will form the spectrum. Next we have f minus fs. F minus fs. Again, this will be having the spectrum from minus fs minus w to minus fs plus w. So this is the spectrum of the sampled signal, that is g del of f. So now we can rewrite the above equation as g del of f as equal to fs into g of f plus summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity n not equal to 0 fs g of f minus n fs. The first term indicates the spectrum without sampling, and the terms under summation represents spectrums repeating at multiple frequencies of sampling frequency fs. So this diagram gives a clear idea about the time domain and frequency domain representation of sampling process. So we have just considered the continuous signal g of t. The spectrum is given as g of f. So in order to sample the signal, we consider the signal del of t. And here we have the spectrum as del of f. So the sampled signal is g del of t, and the spectrum of sampled signal is g del of f. Reconstruction of sampled signal. The Fourier transform of continuous time signal g of t is equal to integral minus infinity to infinity g of t e to the power of minus j 2 pi ft. And the Fourier transform of discontinuous time signal g del of t is equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n ts e to the power of minus j 2 pi fn ts. If the signal g of t is strictly band limited such that there are no frequency components higher than w hertz, then g of f will be equal to 0 for modulus f greater than or equal to w. And we know very well the sampling frequency is equal to 2w or ts is equal to 1 by 2w, where w is the maximum frequency. So in order to reconstruct the sampled signal, the assumptions made are modulus of g of f will be equal to 0 for f greater than or equal to w. And the second assumption is fs is equal to 2w, which is nothing but the sampling rate. The equation g del of f, which is equal to fs g of f plus summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity n not equal to 0 fs g of f minus n fs can be written as fs g of f equal to g del of f minus summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity n not equal to 0 fs g of f minus n fs. Again, rearranging the terms, we have g of f equal to 1 divided by fs g del of f minus 1 by fs summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity n not equal to 0 g of f minus n fs. Applying the assumptions made above, that is g of f is equal to 0 whenever f is greater than or equal to w, we have g of f is equal to 1 divided by 2w g del of f whenever f is lying between minus w to w. We know that Fourier transform g del of t is equal to g del of f. So g of f will be equal to 1 by 2w summation n is equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n ts e to the power of minus j 2 pi fn ts, where ts is equal to 1 by fs or ts is equal to 1 divided by 2w. So now we have g of f is equal to 1 by 2w summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n divided by 2w e to the power of minus j 2 pi fn divided by 2w. That in turn will be equal to 1 divided by 2w summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n divided by 2w e to the power of minus j pi fn by w for f greater than or equal to minus w less than or equal to w. So g of t will be equal to inverse Fourier transform of g of f, which will be equal to inverse Fourier transform of 1 by 2w summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n divided by 2w e to the power of minus j pi fn divided by w. On simplifying, we get the equation as g of t equal to summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity g of n divided by 2w sin pi into 2wt minus n divided by pi into 2wt minus n. Or we can say g of t will be equal to g of 0 sinc 2wt plus g of plus or minus 1 by 2w sync to WT plus or minus 1 and so on. Thus, a delayed sync function is weighed by the amplitude of sample value at a particular instant. Sampling rate of 2W samples per second for a signal bandwidth of W Hz is called as the Nyquist rate, and 1 by 2W is called as the Nyquist interval. So the figure shows the spectrum for various values of Fs. So this one is the spectrum of the continuous signal. When Fs is equal to 2W, the sampled signal spectrum is obtained as shown. And this diagram shows the spectrum of the sampled signal for the condition Fs greater than 2W. And this condition is easy for reconstruction. And this diagram shows the spectrum of the sampled signal for the condition Fs less than 2W. So the samples overlap with each other when Fs is less than 2W, and this condition is known as aliasing. In order to avoid aliasing, a low-pass anti-aliasing filter is used prior to sampling to attenuate the high frequency components. Next, the filtered signal is sampled at a rate higher than the Nyquist rate, that is, when Fs is greater than 2W. Under this condition, there is no aliasing, and when the signal is to be reconstructed, it is made faithfully. So here the diagram shows the conditions to avoid aliasing. So G of T is applied to anti-aliasing filter. The output is sampled at a rate greater than 2W in order to get G del of T. So next we'll see the types of sampling. We have three different types of sampling, that is ideal or instantaneous or impulse sampling. The second one is the natural or chopper sampling. Third one is the flat top or rectangular pulse sampling. So this table gives the comparison between the three different types of sampling. So in instantaneous sampling, it uses the concept of multiplication. That is, the input continuous signal is multiplied with an impulse response in order to get G del of T or the sampled signal. So the samples are obtained only at that particular instant of time. Whereas natural sampling uses the principle of chopping. In order to generate natural sampled signal, the input continuous signal is applied to the switch, and this switch is controlled with the help of pulses. The output generates natural sampled signal. So the natural sampled signal will be having the chopped pulses. Hence it is also called as chopper sampling. And the flat top sampling uses the principle of sample and hold. The input signal is applied to the sample and hold circuit in order to get the flat top sampled output. So this is how the flat top sampled output will be obtaining. And the equations for all the different types of sampling is given here. So the second process in the process of conversion of analog signal to digital signal is quantization. Amplitude quantizing is nothing but mapping samples of continuous amplitude waveform to a finite set of amplitudes. So here the input is the sampled signal and the output is the quantized output. In order to obtain the quantized output, we'll be dividing the output into various levels, and these levels will be having the step. The next process in the conversion of analog signal to digital signal is quantization. So we have what is called as the amplitude quantizing, which is nothing but mapping the samples of a continuous amplitude waveform to a finite set of amplitudes. So for the quantization, the input is the sampled input signal and the output is the quantized output. For example, if the amplitude of the continuous signal is having a peak voltage of Vp, then we'll be dividing that entire Vp into various levels. And the difference between each level is called as Q, which is nothing but the step size, which will be equal to 2Vp divided by the number of levels. So the quantization noise power will be given by Q square divided by 12. So next we'll see with an example what is the exact process involved in quantization. So we know very well the input will be the sampled input, output will be the quantized output. So initially the entire amplitude will be divided into various levels called as the quantization levels. So here we have considered 8 different levels starting from minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1 till 1, 2, 3, 4. Each and every level will be assigned with the binary data starting from 000 till 111 since we are considering 8 different levels. So now for this levels, we are just going to assign a boundary value. That is, the center of the levels is called as the boundaries. So now I consider a continuous analog signal. And we are going to obtain the samples of this analog signal at the points indicated by the red dot. So consider the first point. This point is just above the boundary. So this will be assigned with the quantized value, that is the next higher value, that with indicated by this green box. So the second sample is also assigned with a higher level. And if you consider here, the sampled value is below the boundary. Because of that, the quantized value will be the lower level. Similarly, we can assign the quantized level for all the values. The corresponding binary values will be transmitted. That is, for this one, the corresponding binary value is 111, 111, and so on. So this is the process involved in quantization. Types of quantization. So quantization is broadly divided into two types, that is uniform quantization, wherein the step size assigned will be having a constant value. And the next one is non-uniform quantization, wherein we'll be assigning a variable step size. Uniform quantization is further divided into two types, that is mid-tread quantization and mid-rise quantization. So in mid-tread quantization, in the characteristic curve, the middle point will be having a tread. Whereas in mid-rise quantization, in the midpoint will be having a rise. So similarly, non-uniform quantization is classified into two types, that is A law as well as mu law. A law is such that the output voltage is given by this equation, and mu law is such that the output voltage is given by this equation. So non-uniform quantization, we know very well, in non-uniform quantization, we'll be assigning variable step size. It is done by uniformly quantizing the compressed signal. So at the receiver, an inverse compression characteristic called as expansion is employed to avoid signal distortion. So compression plus expansion is called as compounding. So compounding is nothing but compressing the signal at the transmitter and expanding the signal at the receiver. For example, the signal x of t is compressed at the transmitter. So output is indicated as y of t. This is assigned with a uniform quantization. Output is white cap of T. At the receiver, the signal will be expanded and finally will be getting X cap of T. So this is how the non-uniform quantization is achieved. So this is the characteristic curve for mu law compounding and A law compounding. Pulse code modulation. A signal is pulse code modulated to convert its analog information into a binary sequence, that is, ones and zeros. The output of a PCM will resemble a binary sequence. PCM is the standard form of digital audio in computers, compact disc, digital telephony and other digital audio applications. Basic elements of PCM. The transmitter section of a pulse code modulator consists of sampling, quantizing and encoding, which are performed in the analog to digital converter section. So the figure shows the block diagram of PCM modulator and demodulator. So the input message signal is applied to the low pass filter. So this filter eliminates the high frequency components present in the input analog signal, and which is greater than the highest frequency of the message signal. And this is useful in avoiding aliasing. So the output of the low pass filter is applied to the sampler. So this is the technique which helps to collect the sample data at instantaneous values of message signal so as to reconstruct the original signal. So the sampling rate here must be greater than twice the highest frequency component W of the message signal in accordance with the sampling theorem. So the sampled output is applied to the quantizer. So quantizing is a process of converting analog sample of the signal into a discrete form. The resultant signal is discrete both in time and amplitude. So these three sections, that is low pass filter, sampler and quantizer, will act as an analog to digital converter. So the output of the quantizer is applied to the encoder. So the digitization of analog signal is done by the encoder. It designates each quantized level by a binary code. The electrical representation of a code is also done by assigning a waveform or a pulse in the encoder. So the output of the encoder is the PCM wave. Encoding minimizes the bandwidth used. So the encoded output is the PCM wave and this is transmitted using the channel. So when the signal is getting transmitted by the channel, it will be affected with the noise. So we are using regenerative repeater in order to increase the signal strength. So the output of the channel has regenerative repeater circuit to compensate the signal loss and reconstruct the signal and also to increase its strength. The output of the regenerative repeater is the reconstructed signal. So this regenerated PCM is given to the receiver. The most important feature of PCM system lies in the ability to control the effects of distortion and noise produced by transmitting PCM wave through the channel. So the regenerated signal is applied to the decoder. The decoder circuit decodes the pulse-coded waveform to reproduce the original signal. So this circuit acts as a demodulator. So the output of the decoder is applied to the reconstruction filter. after the digital to analog conversion done by the regenerative circuit and the decoder, a low-pass filter is employed called as the reconstruction filter to get back the original signal. Hence, the pulse code modulator circuit digitizes the given analog signal, codes it and samples it and then transmits it in an analog form. This whole process is repeated in a reverse pattern to obtain the original signal. So this is how the signal is transmitted using a PCM modulator, received and reconstructed by a PCM demodulator. Time division multiplexing. So in telecommunications and computer networks, multiplexing is a method by which multiple analog or digital signals are combined into one signal over a shared medium. The multiplexed signal is transmitted using a single communication channel such as cable. So, types of multiplexing. Multiplexing is broadly classified as analog multiplexing and digital multiplexing. So, whenever we are combining analog signals, it's called as analog multiplexing. And whenever we are combining digital signals, it's called as digital multiplexing. So, analog multiplexing is further divided into FDM, frequency division multiplexing, that is separation in frequency, WDM, wave division multiplexing, whereas digital multiplexing is further divided into time division multiplexing. Under time division multiplexing, in telecommunications and computer networks, multiplexing is a method by which multiple analog or digital signals are combined into one signal over a shared medium. The multiplex signal is transmitted using a single communication channel such as cable. So, multiplexing is broadly classified into analog multiplexing and digital multiplexing. Analog multiplexing is further divided into frequency division multiplexing and wave division multiplexing. Under digital multiplexing, we have time division multiplexing. So, under time division multiplexing, we have synchronous time division multiplexing and statistical time division multiplexing. So, an important feature of pulse amplitude modulated signal or sampled signal is conservation of time. That is, for a given message signal, transmission engages the communication channel only for a fraction of time. Hence, some of the interval between the adjacent pulses of a PAM signal is cleared for use by other independent message signals on a time shared basis. We obtain time division multiplex signal, which enables joint utilization of a common channel by a plurality of independent message signals without mutual interference. So, the figure shows the time division multiplexed process. So, each message signal is restricted in bandwidth by a low-pass pre-alias filter to remove the frequencies that are non-essential to an adequate signal representation. So, we have considered n different signals. All the n signals will be passed through a low-pass filter. So, the output of low-pass filter is applied to the commutator, which is an electronic switch. The function of the commutator is to take a narrow sample of each of the n input message signal at a rate fs slightly higher than 2w and to sequentially interleave these n samples inside a sampling interval ts equal to 1 by fs. So the output of this commutator is applied to pulse modulator. So the multiplexed signal at the output of the commutator is passed through PAM, and the purpose of which is to transform the multiplexed signal into a form suitable for transmission over the communication channel. Suppose N message signals to be multiplexed have similar spectral properties, then the sampling rate for each message signal is determined in accordance with the sampling theorem. At the receiving end, the received signal is applied to PAM demodulator. This output is distributed to the low pass reconstruction filter by means of decommutator, which operates in synchronization with the commutator in the transmitter. So the output of the channel is passed through pulse demodulator, and with the help of decommutator, the corresponding signals is applied to the corresponding low pass filter in order to get back the original message signal. For example, consider two message signals. So the blue color indicates one set of samples and red color indicates the next set of samples. So now this is the switch. Initially, the switch will be connected to the first low pass filter. Hence, the blue color sample will be transmitted. So next, the switch will be connected to the second low pass filter, that is the second sample signal will be transmitted. So this will be repeated. So the switch will be oscillating between first low pass filter and second low pass filter. So we'll be getting the sampled signal or time division multiplexed signal. So this is how we are going to get time division multiplexed signal. So here we can study that with the help of the waveform. So we have considered the waveform for first signal as well as the second signal. So initially the sample of first signal will be obtained in TDM, followed by the sample of the second signal, and then the sample of the first signal and second signal. So we'll be getting the time division multiplexed signal. So time division multiplexing provides an effective method for sharing a communication channel among multiple analog sources. Telephone based applications uses pulse coded modulation signals, which further uses time division multiplexing for the efficient use of channel bandwidth. TDM finds applications in 2G cellular system and wideband transmission.